Hi, how are you? Thank you so much for joining us tonight. My name is Brittany Bang, and I have the great pleasure this evening of being your moderator tonight of some wonderful, amazing thriller mystery, and I'm going to say adventure authors with us tonight, because I really think there are some great adventure stories. Something that you all might not know is I also write about adventures, but for a very different reading audience. I am a children's book author, and I have a series called Little Mouse's Adventures. Little Mouse's Adventures is supposed to represent the children's view of the children, the way they look at the world, and big and bright and all around them. So those are my adventure stories. But tonight's audience and reading audience is a very different type. So I don't think the Kate and Leo's books are appropriate for the children that I write for, but it's a pleasure to be here with you. I have been very fortunate to get to know Leo through his writing and some of other projects that we work on, and now I've got to know Kate as well, so I figure we're lifelong friends as well, correct, Kate?
Absolutely.
Absolutely, okay, good.
I mean, actually, I hate people who can wear pencil skirts, but.
I have to look good next to the man here, Leo, so that's what I always try to do. So. Kate, thank you for joining us tonight. We did have a kind of a last-minute lineup, but it's really so wonderful to have you. And I'm going to read to you all a little bit about Kate, and I'm really excited to turn it over. But just to keep you updated on who we have speaking with us tonight and the real reason that we're all here. Kate Flora is the author of 14 mystery and true crime books. Death Dealer, her latest true crime, is an Agatha Anthony finalist and won the Public Safety Writers Association Award for Best Nonfiction in 2015. And Grant Your Peace, her latest Joe Burgess Police won the 2015 Maine Literary Award for Crime Fiction. Her other titles include the Thea Kozak Mysteries and the star-reviewed Joe Burgess Police Series. Coming in 2016 will be the new Thea Kozak Mystery, which I'm sure we're all excited to hear more about. Death Warned Over, and a fifth Joe Burgess police procurial, and the lead theme, you have a lot of great titles. Wow, that's great. And Led Them Best Astray, and our collaboration with Marine Game Warden Roger Gary on his memoir, A Good Man with a Dog. Also in the works is a serial novel about the killing of a famous TV chef's beat, Slay and Love, and the imaginary Thea Filbert she wrote with four other crime writers. The really exciting part is Kate's a former assistant attorney general for the state of Maine in the areas of child abuse and child support enforcement. Kate is a founding member of the New England Crime Bake and Maine Crime Wave conferences. She has served as an editor and publisher of Level Best Books and an international president of Sisters of Crime. So that's a little bit about Kate this evening. And the handsome gentleman who she's sitting next to, plus when I give him a hard time. This is the fun part about getting to know the people you're talking about. Is none other than Leo J. Maloney. Leo is a former deep cover black operative for a clandestine government agency. Leo was born here in Massachusetts, and where he graduated high school and attended Northeastern University. In the mid-1960s, while in the Army, he was recruited to become that deep cover black operative contractor for the clandestine government agency. While serving his country in the secretive world of black ops for 30 years, he operated several cover businesses, including a classic car brokerage, promotions and limousine company, and detective agency. He served as a municipal police officer right here in Revere, Mass., and still a licensed police private investigator in the state of Massachusetts. In his most recent project, Leo began writing, revealing many of his black op experiences and involving them into his books. In 2011, he signed a contract with Kensington Publishing Corporation for the Dan Morgan thriller series. His first book, Termination Orders, was released in September 2012. Silent Assassin, Black Skies, and 12 Hours were released respectively in 2012, 13, and 14. Leo has signed a movie deal with Amber Entertainment to bring the Dan Morgan thriller series to the big screen, and it's slated to begin filming shortly. So thank you both so much for being here tonight, and I'm excited to hear a little bit more, and I'm sure so is everybody else.
I always find it extremely intimidating to do anything with Leo. Mostly, I found that my role in being on stage with Leo is that I get to sit here and do my Ben White number, which you'll see me do very well as Leo's talks. But one of the things that I think is really interesting is that, and she's the moderator, but I could start interviewing you and I could say, what on earth possessed you to go from your covert life to this incredibly overt life of being a writer?
Well, a couple of things. My ex-partner and I had talked about writing books on dating with book 11. He died, and unfortunately he passed away, so that opportunity never presented itself to us. And then 2001, I got married in 2001, and after I told my wife what I really did, she would say to me, you should write a book, you should write a book, you should write a book. And I kept saying, no, 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 no. And then finally, in, it must have been 2007, I decided to do it and started putting together my first book. I found I had a knack for it, and one thing led to another, and I wound up self-publishing a book. And after I self-published it, I was very lucky. My editor from Kensington was on vacation down Cape Cod and saw my book in a self-published book in a store there. She bought the book and read it, and then called me at my house and. Basically, we had a conversation, a really strange conversation.
I know what that smile is over there.
Should I tell the story?
I don't know.
You've heard it before. Should I tell it?
Of course you should.
Okay.
People like the story.
All right, so
it's a good story.
I get a phone call from my house on a Monday morning, August 11th, 2011, at 11 a.m. The phone rings, and there's this little voice in the end that sounded like the Good Witch in the original Wizard of Oz. Glenda, really nice voice, and says to me, is this Leo? And I said, yes, it is. And she says, my name's Michael Hamilton. I'm the editor-in-chief from Kensington Publishing, New York. And just recently, I had been over somebody's house and had talked to them about the book and told them all about it. And this person's wife was there and heard it, and she's kind of a ball buster. And she just said, I thought that was her breaking my chops. So I'm being kind of smiling on the phone. And she said, so I read your book and I really thought it was good. And I come across, oh, really? And she said, yes. She said, would you, and I'm going to speed this up, Susan, would you be interested in coming to New York and talking to me about a book deal? I said, really? And she said, yeah. She said, we really like, when would you be interested? So I said, oh, let me think about this. Yeah, I'll come down. When do you want me to come down? She said, well, when do you want to come down? He says, how about if I come down tomorrow? I said, I'll come down by train from Boston. I'll take it to, from South Station to Penn Station in New York. And he says, all right, when you get your itinerary, call me, let me know, and I'll arrange to meet you that next morning. We'll go for breakfast. So I said, sure, okay. And we had a little more conversation. Finally, I had enough of this, because I felt as though it was nonsense. Phone rang back within seconds. No, maybe a minute.
She had to catch her breath.
Yeah, this woman is just adorable. I pick up the phone and I look at the caller ID, which I had the first time, and it said Kensington Publishing. And I went, oh crap. So I didn't hit the phone. I just let it ring. I need to think. Another minute or so, a minute and a half went by, phone rings again, I look at Kensington Publishing. So I went, hello. She goes, hello, Leo. I said, yes, this is he. She goes, this is Michael Hamilton, Kensington Publishing. And I said, oh, I said, Miss Hamilton, if you give me approximately 30 seconds, 45 seconds, I'm going to explain to you what just happened. So I tell her the story. And she's listening, and then she's kind of laughing, and then she says to me, wow, that makes sense. I've got to tell you, though, this is the first time in 25 years that I called a potential author to sign a deal with us, and he told me to go myself before he knew what the author was. And therefore, I built my relationship, and her and I have a very special, unique relationship. my relationship is different than any other authors, and she tells me this all the time. I've got her home phone number. I can call her at home. When I get out of New York, she'll take my wife and I out to dinner. She'll take us to plays. And we just become very good friends. So it's a very neat and strange way to start off a business. I signed initially a 2-deal book with an option for more. And then as soon as my first book came out, we did another 2-book deal, another 2-book deal. I'm working on book 5 and novella 6. I just turned book 5 in. No, sorry. 4th full book, and I'm working on the novella, 2nd novella now. And I've got, so all together, I've got a 9-book deal, which is going to take me into Maloney. So that's how it all came about.
So Leo, we know that you have kind of a rough and tough past, so you can speak like that to some people. But Kate, I mean, I've just got to know you recently, but come on, I mean, you seem like such a wonderful person. How did you start writing about cops and all this tough stuff?
Oh, you know, it's very nice of you to ask. My mother-in-law, may she rest in peace, used to say, that lovely girl, those awful books. I came out of the Attorney General's office. I came out of practicing law, and practicing law, one of the things that I saw, because although I wasn't doing criminal stuff, I was doing the hard stuff in the civil side. I was doing deadbeat dads and battered kids and abusive parents, the Human Rights Commission and human rights abuses and so forth for the state of Maine. And one of the things that fascinated me was that everywhere that I went, people lied. People who thought of themselves as respectable, decent people would lie. They would lie about anything where their own interests were involved. And I got to think about, you know, this was at a level that was serious, but not life and death. But in the life and death world, which is the world that the world of crime deals with primarily, there are a lot of people who believe that their actions that they take, the rules that they break, are justified. And I was deeply curious about what it is about some people's makeup, their psychology, their background, that lets them decide that they're entitled to opt out of the social contract that we've all signed on to. And then the other piece of it was that I started out writing strong women books. I started out, as all those of us who grew up reading Nancy Drew, wanted to write the book where the woman saves herself instead of the big tough guy jumping out of the closet saying, "I'll save you, dear," though I wouldn't mind if they don't save me. So I wanted to write strong women. And how I got into cops, well, that's another story, but maybe we should take turns here because I could talk all night.
Well, I think Leo can too, so Leo, I mean, I think one of the most amazing things that I've always loved knowing about you and reading about you is so much of your, you know, personal experiences is brought into your books with the Dan Morgan Thriller series. But I mean, talk to us a little bit more before the writing. Talk to us about what did you like about being a black operative? I know it's such an important part of your history that has led you here today. So, you know, I think so many of our listeners love to hear that side.
Well, there are several things that I loved about the job. First of all, I think that just goes wrong. Okay. The fact I was a contractor, and when I graduated my training facility, I had several options. One of them being a deep cover black operative contractor, and I chose that option basically because it allowed me to decide what assignment I would take and what assignment I wouldn't take, and that gave me flexibility. I've got some friends in here that know me for a while, and I think that I was never one to really like to take orders from people, especially if I thought there was nothing between their ears. So this gave me that flexibility. Once I decided to take an assignment, I had everything I needed. They would provide everything, every asset, anything I needed to make the assignment work and to fulfill it, I was supplied. It also was the fact that I had so many different assignments. There was no such thing as a regular work day. Everything was different all the time. I traveled in many different parts of the world, saw many different things, experienced different things. Those were a lot of things I liked. And the fact that when I did this work, I was paid pretty well, and I had a nice expense account, and it allowed me to venture out and create these cover stories that I created. And as they said, I had an antique classic custom car company, which I sold and dealt with classic cars, various classic cars, and muscle cars, things all over there. And I took it from nothing and built it into a real company. I did the same thing with a promotions company. So with the money I made for them, I knew I could earn money whenever I wanted. And it allowed me to do these things, and I actually built them into businesses and then sold them. So, you know, that was a flexibility that a lot of people don't have in this lifetime. And I was lucky enough to spend 30 years. So the life expectancy for someone who did what I did was less than 7 years. I lasted 30, and I was very lucky, very lucky. A lot of people that I worked with, the people that I worked with, strictly worked with teams on me. Let me tell you a little bit. All right, I don't want to back up. So the Deep Cover Black Rock, nobody knows who you are. I haven't seen him for my entire career. Other than my handler, very few people within the agency knew who I was, and that was for our protection. I could have sat across having lunch with somebody right there, and unless I had worked with them on an assignment, they didn't know who I was, and I didn't know who they was, and that was for our protection. So within the agency itself, very few people knew who we were. And until I came out in 2001, Chris found out. So, I mean, those are some of the things. It's just the freedom to do what I wanted, to carry on the sign of what I wanted, to say no when I wanted. You know, those were all really great things that, you know, it was perfect for me.
So, you know, okay, I think that brings us back to Leo's just saying that he really writes about a lot of his life, and that's where the inspiration of a lot of his characters were. You have never been a black op unless you're about to come out of a closet that we don't know about tonight. So, you know, how do you write about these characters that you feel authentic in bringing back to the cops?
You know? I have no secrets, you know, none.
Darn. I was hoping this was going to be breaking news tonight.
That would be really cool. I've often thought I should make up an imaginary past, because people like pasts, and, you know, and then when you write stuff, it'll sound so much more authentic. But I guess I describe myself not as someone who writes from my own experience so much as I am a translator. And I'm a thief. I steal other people's stories. I steal other people's souls. I am the person who at the cocktail party should be wearing the little pin that's very small letters, but what it says is, be careful what you tell me. Because I'm a writer and I will use it. I will use anything and everything. I can't drive down the street without something happening that matters that is going to end up in a book. But the way that I got into writing cops, which is somewhat different from being, you know, a lawyer back when women didn't become lawyers writing about strong women, is that my strong women series got dropped by the publisher. And I sat there thinking, I can go back to practicing law. Or I can take chances. And one of the things that I know about from writing for 25 years is that when you take chances on doing the thing that scares you, when you sort of go out on the tightrope, your writing gets better if you really dig in, because it's hard and you have to work for it. And so I said, I've spent all this time going and talking to the cops. You know, I was running in and out of the police chief's office all the time. I was taking, you know, the Citizens Police Academy and doing this and doing that. And I said, police officers fascinate me. They're doing something really important that they don't get a lot of credit for. And I think it would be really fun to write police procedurals, because I love to read them. So I'm going to take on the task of writing three middle-aged guys. And, you know, it's easier to write a woman than it is to write a guy. And it's easier to write another lawyer than it would be to write a cop. But I am really thrilled that the cops say, sometimes they think I understand their lives better than they do. So I dug in, I've done it. I spend a lot of time, you know, with them. I've written two true crimes, which were, you know, looking over the cop's shoulders about real world murders. And I have also spent all that time with the game warden, who did cadaver dog stuff and search and rescue, helping him write his memoir. So I have a lot of people who helped me to try and get it right, and thank goodness for that.
So Kate, you write both fiction and nonfiction, which is just very unique, I feel like. What is the difference in that writing process? Do you prefer one or the other? I mean, it sounds like you really just love the craft, but and it's so personal.
That's a hard question. I hate writing true crime. That being said, I have just this month taken on a task of helping a police officer write about officer-involved shootings, which is a big book, because he can get people to talk to him, and I can translate that into words. But it's so much harder than writing fiction. I mean, the nice thing about fiction is you get to make it up. You know, you control the characters. I say you control the horizontal, you control the vertical. There's nothing more perfect in this world than an imaginary man.
Amen.
Because, you know, I mean, they behave. What I've discovered, you know, and then I will shut up, coming down this road is that having gone from writing cops, writing fiction, to writing nonfiction, writing fiction taught me how to help people tell a nonfiction story and to tell a nonfiction story in a way that gave it a dramatic story arc and made it a book that you really wanted to read and really needed to finish. And spending all of that time with real people talking about dealing with real bad guys has taught me how to write my fiction in a much deeper and more dimensioned way. And so I'm just about the luckiest writer there is because people trust me to tell stories, and so they tell me things. It's amazing.
So, you know, we've heard about that. And so, Leah, we heard a little bit about your past. And, you know, I think one of the things, again, I'm very privy to knowing is through our friendship is really the inspiration behind Dan Morgan, the Dan Morgan Thriller series. And, you know, I've always been very impressed when you really do talk about the inspiration behind Dan Morgan, and I don't know if people really realize how closely you are associated. Tell us about, you know, Dan Morgan, and of course, you know, your partner in the series, and a little bit more about the inspiration behind your characters.
Excuse me. So, the main protagonist of my books is obviously Dan Morgan. Dan Morgan is me, and I am Dan Morgan. If you read any of my books, what you see is really what you get in real life. Peter Conley, who was my partner for many, many years, is in the book. Obviously, that's not his real name, but he was my partner. He and I were like brothers. We had been through things and had done things and seen things that people only see in movies. And we were so in tune with each other that we could be, I'm sitting here, he's sitting back there, and we would know what the other two was thinking. We would just know what each other was thinking. It was unbelievable, it was uncanny. And we were so close, we did so many things. I mean, both working as my partner and I would say we worked together probably 75% of the time on the same case, and other times we were individual cases. But when we weren't working, Peter was exactly opposite of me. So Peter was 6'3", blonde hair, blue eyes. He had a very, not bulky muscular, but very wiry muscular. Spoke 7 languages, was a gourmet cook, had his helicopter pilot license, his airplane pilot license, his captain's boat license. There were some other things he did, but great athlete, and I speak no languages. There were times when we would go on assignment, and I got very good at this because I picked up a little bit of various languages here and there during my career. Hey, shut it off. That's my wife. That's what I'm saying. So I picked up various things that I had to know, like why. I got to know what people were saying somewhat, but I didn't have to speak. If we were on a mission, depending where we were, he spoke 7 different languages, and most of the missions we went, that was the language we spoke. I would actually stand there, and I would act like I was deaf and dumb. And the hardest thing, and I trained to do this, the hardest thing was, if someone's saying something about you and it isn't necessarily nice, to keep a straight face. And I learned how to do it and was very good at it. So, you know, my characters and other characters in the book, all my characters in the book are drawn from people that I either worked with or worked against in different parts of the world. So that's where I draw things from. It's strictly from, you know, my experiences, and I find by doing that, it's easy. I mean, I'm not a trained writer. I never went to school to learn how to write. What I found when I wrote was I had a ghostwriter who I actually still, he still works for me. So the first book, it was about 95% him writing. I wrote 5%. But the stories, I created the stories and the characters. And the second book, by the time we did the second book, it was about 75-25. Third book was about 50-50. My fourth book, it's about 90-10 me. And then my novella, the entire novella, or at least 99% was written by me. So I've learned, you know, relatively quick learner. I've learned a lot, and I can write my own stuff. But what I like the best is being able to write between this. The weirdest times, I just get something pop into my head, and I get up in the middle of the night, 2-3 o'clock, and I start writing. And I'll sit there and write and put these ideas, and she'll say to me, "How do you think of that? That's sick. Where do you come up with these things?" Well, a lot that I come up with from things I've seen and experienced. And some one of the things my when I talk about our unique relationship is, I don't have to a lot of writers have to send in this synopsis where there's all these chapters and the outline. I don't have to do any of that stuff. I come up with my idea and I send her one synopsis, the three chapters, and she leaves me alone until I'm done the book, until I'm done the manuscript, then I turn it in. And then of course I'll get back with edits. But that's one great thing. And what she's allowed me to do is I can be in the middle of writing a story and something happens today, whether it's in Iran, Afghanistan, it doesn't matter where it is. I can take that and turn that into a story like that because of my experiences. And that's what's the best. I have never had writer's block. I don't know if you have, but I haven't. And then that's because I'm allowed to just, I mean, I sent her a complete manuscript, and, well, almost complete. She read it, she loved it. And then when I sent her the next one, the completed one, I had completely changed it like better. So it's very unique, and I'm very lucky that way. I know a lot of writers, I mean, I've got a lot of friends that I've met over the last 5 years, and they don't have that freedom that I have, which is a great thing. So I hope that answers your question.
Holy, I hope so too. So I have a follow-up question with that one. So you've told us a lot about what you've learned through the writing process, and you also told us a little bit about your first interesting meeting with Michaela, on the phone. But as far as, you know, you told us all that you originally self-published Termination Orders, your first book, and then it was picked up. So what have you learned about the publishing industry? Because I do know you, and you don't like to take orders. So now that someone else is telling you, you know, what to do with your books, what have you learned about the publishing industry in general that's, you know, so okay, so foreign for so many of us?
All right, so the difference between self-publishing and publishing is when you have a mainstream publisher, you don't have to do all those things you do when you self-publish. You don't have to go out and hustle your book and get it understood. They do that for you. What you do is you write. When you're done writing, I send it in. They publicize it. I have a publicist in New York. I also have a local publicist here in Massachusetts, but I have a publicist in Kensington. I don't have to take my books like I did the first self-publishing and take them to stores. And I was very lucky because one of my business was a promotion. I understood how to promote myself. So I went in, I got my book into Walgreens. I got it into 26 Walgreens stores throughout the United States. I walked into my local Walgreens manager. I said, "Hi, I live down the street. I wrote a book. Would you consider taking it on consignment?" He said, "Well, I need to read it first." I said, "Okay." He took it, he read it, called me back the next day, came in and said, "We're going to take your books, but I've also contacted our headquarters, and they're going to put you in 26 stores around the country." I went, "Whoa, okay."
This doesn't normally happen, folks. I just want to let you all know that doesn't happen.
So that was, and then I went out and started going to independent bookstores. There's people outside selling books, they're from Stone. I walked up and did the same thing. So my books are out there, they did very good. But with all that being said, my goal was to sign with a mainstream publisher. And the minute I signed with, I mean, no more lugging books in my car, no more begging people, no more, just, they do it. They get you, you know, they get, I have a publicist here who gets me some of the gigs like this, and others I call libraries and I talk to them where I want to go. But they do all that heavy lifting for you. It allows you to write, which is really nice, really nice.
That's great. Yeah, Kate, what is your experience? I mean, tell me a little bit about your process and how you kind of got started, because it is, it's just such a different journey for everybody.
Oh dear. No, I actually hate talking about the publishing side. I know that's really silly. I'm such a, you know, passionate writing teacher, you know, writing coach, all that stuff. That's where I play. This, you know, by my book dance and the, you know, the games and the ups and the downs and the getting the publisher to actually do the things that you need to have them do for you. I'm just gonna make Leo my new best friend, and he can carry my books into Walgreens too, and that would be really nice. Actually, one thing that's true is that if you have a hardcover book, which I have always had, they're actually harder to sell than a paperback original. All of the years that I've been being published in, this is, I think, my 25th year, I have had these, you know, all my friends are saying, I only came out in paperback and you came out in hardcover, and I, you know, I'm so jealous, and I really, really, my goal in life, you know, what's your goal? My goal in life is to have a hardcover book. My goal in life is to have a paperback original, because they're so much easier to sell. Because you can get people to, you know, spend $8 to $12 for a book, but it's really hard to get people to spend $25. And this year I had not one, but two books come out at the same time, and so I was actually competing with myself. So people would say, which book should I buy? And I would say, well, you know, the only thing the author can say in all honesty is please buy both of them, so the children can have shoes. The children are grown and married, they have shoes, but you know, you do what you can. But you know, I've been up, I've been down. I've had big publishers, I've had small publishers, I've had massive contracts, I've had little contracts. So I see the business as kind of a flow, and it's now sort of lost, it doesn't know where it is. But, you know, I'd much rather talk about things like writer's block, which, like Leo, I don't get. I don't believe in it. When my students will sit there, I teach for Grub Street in Boston, and my students will sit there and say, well, what about writer's block? How do we handle it? I say, I don't believe in writer's block, my favorite word that you're going to hate. Right after creativity comes discipline. You know, doctors don't get up in the morning and say, oh my goodness me, you know, I have medical block. And, and also, it's a learning process. We've been learning how to do this. You know, you started with the 90-10, and now you're at the 100%. And that, you know, it's sort of like we've apprenticed and now we can do it. But then the people will come to us and they will say, basically, oh, you're a writer. I've always wanted to write. And sometime when I have a free weekend, I'm going to write a book. And I think that's like marvelous, and more power to them. But I tried it once, you know, because I've been hearing this over the years, and I thought, these people can write a book in a weekend. And it takes me anywhere from 6 months to a year and a half, depending on the book. And the true crimes, the last one, Death Dealer, which is a Canadian murder, took 5 years, but that's because the guy kept getting appeals and new trials. So I decided I'd see how fast I could write a book. And the first Joe Burgess, Playing God, I wrote in 4.5 months. When I was done, it was 485 pages long, and my agent said, well, dear, you know, I think this book has promise, but it will have more promise when you take 100 pages out of it. So I took 100 pages out. So it probably took me longer to rewrite than it did to write. But I couldn't do it in a weekend. I'm just a failure.
I want to say something about that. So, as I said, I'm not a trained writer, but a quick study. I hired a ghostwriter who, to this day, he's still on my payroll. And when I write, I'll get everything out to him, and I've gotten a lot better, but he still has a trained eye. So he'll say things or word things a little differently than I do. So we'll always stay together. I mean, as long as I write, and as long as my editor, Michael, is with Kensington, I'll continue to write. When she stops, she's about 62. So when she stops, I'm stopping because I could never go and deal with somebody else differently because I've had it so good with her. But my first book, termination on it, took 3 years. That was the self-publishing. And then once I signed the deal with Kim's, they took termination on us and they changed the cover and we added about another, I guess it was probably 50 to 75 additional pages of a little more story. And then my second book, I wrote in less than a year. And then the third one, I wrote, and now I'm talking about every 8 months. And the novella I did in about 4 months. But the novella was really cool because that was actually the only book that I've written so far that I actually went and I did research on. I never did research on the books because I did them from all up here, but I went down and I spent time in New York City. I wrote 12 Hours, which is the novella, in the same manner as the show 24 in live time. And I got to see things in New York City and meet people, Grand Central Station and the Waldorf Astoria, down in the bowels of Grand Central Station, which is stuff down there you wouldn't believe. So that was a really, for me, that was actually fun. Because I'd never done it before. And now I kind of, I don't want to do it a whole lot, but I do like going out and once in a while doing some research.
You know, Leo, if you need them, I've got an extra 100 pages, which I'm happy to give you. I actually love going out and doing research because I've been sitting at a desk for all these many, many, many years, and when I get a chance to get out, it's like, it's so exciting. It's like getting out of school. So I sort of store up my questions. I started a new Joe Burgess a few months back, and I had written about 3 pages, and I realized that I had 3 pages worth of questions. You know, like, I need to know what caliber of gun the bad guy is using, and I need to know what kind of ammunition he's using, and I need to know all of these different things. And so, you know, there's nothing more fun, really. I mean, and of course, the thing is, I've been doing it long enough now, so I'll send out a little email. It says, only emails go out with help in the subject line. Sometimes author needs help, and then I'll, you know, email people. And I'll get back these wonderfully cryptic answers because they think I know stuff. So then I have to write back and say, you're dealing with an idiot here. You have to spell it all out. And they're very, very sweet. But one of my favorite research things was when I was working on the last Thea Kozak mystery. Thea is married to a Maine State Trooper. So when the furnace is out in the basement, she grabs a flashlight to go down in the basement and, you know, see what's going on. And I realized that she's a cop's wife. So she's not going to grab the flashlight that I'm going to grab as a civilian in Concord, Massachusetts. She's going to grab the flashlight that her husband thinks she should be carrying because it has all the right attributes. So instead of just, you know, first I did all the research, you know, all the cop forums where they talk about, you know, no, it's the this one, no, it's the that one, no, you know, I want the rechargeable one, well, I want the one with batteries because the rechargeable one always dies on you right in the middle of wherever. I carry 2 and I carry 3 and the ones the department gives you are crap. And, you know, so I send out this email and I get back a novel's worth of flashlight stories, including one from a guy who's a retired Oakland detective that says, like me, Joe Burgess came on the force about 20 plus years ago. And back then we were issued, you know, these super heavy mag lights, you know, and you know, they served many purposes in addition to illumination, not the least of which was that when people got out of hand, they made an excellent weapon for subduing the bad guy. And you know, it's that kind of thing that you know it. I have to figure out that I don't know it and need to know it, and then go find people like you to answer my questions.
You know, it makes my my research for my adventure stories. I had to walk the Freedom Trail recently make sure that little mouse in every stop on the Freedom Trail. So these adventures in research seem a lot more exciting all of a sudden, but it's really interesting to hear the process of the both of you, so thank you. I think people are probably getting tired of hearing me, but Leo, what's next for, you know, the Dan Morgan Thriller series and you, Leo J. Maloney?
Well, as I said, I just turned in my latest novel. It's called
Morgan's Revenge.
No, no, no.
Oh.
no.
Shaking up.
I'll think of it.
Don't we love that?
What's
the book's gone.
What is it?
Our Chinaman.
Just turned the manuscript in about 3 weeks ago. We're doing some edits. I'm working on a new book. It's kind of untitled. We're not sure. We might call it Morgan's Revenge. It's a novella.
Totally off base.
Okay,
I didn't pull that one
out. Right now, I'm going to write a full-blown book, then a novella, then a full-blown book. So that's the process until I can't write anymore. The other thing I really am involved in is a year ago, I took on a charity called Mission Canine Rescue. And these dogs are military dogs that serve our nation in various hot spots of the world, Iraq, Afghanistan, various places. And they're trained by our government with handlers, and they serve right alongside the military counterpart. Eat, sleep, drink, and die with them. What happens when these dogs are over there, and they're not only military dogs, there's private contractor dogs as well, falls under this Mission Canine Rescue. And unfortunately what happens is, if a handler is killed, the dog goes one or two places. It will go to Germany in a kennel, just be there forever. Or they're left where the particular country they are in. If you leave dogs over in Afghanistan and Iraq, they eat them. So this organization was formed by a former military guy who started it. And what they do is, the main thing is, Mission Canine Rescue is getting these dogs. And they have, you know, besides the handler being killed, the handler may just get out. It's tour duty, they go up. The dog doesn't come back. It's very expensive. They consider our government, our current government, considers these dogs equipped. That's what they treat them like. Not only the tank, leave the tanks, leave the dogs. So they form this organization. The first thing they do is try to get them back over here. And to bring the dog back runs somewhere around $300 to $3,500 to get them back. Once you get them back, then they've got to be treated. Many of them suffer from traumatic stress disorder, various other injuries. So the first thing is getting them back, treating them, getting them healed. Once they heal and they can, you know, live some of them normal life, they try to reunite them with their handlers. They just reunited in the last month or so, reunited 12 of them, which was amazing. And if they can't be reunited with the handlers, then what they do is, the next thing is they try to get them and place them with somebody in the military. These dogs have highly trained. You just don't take them and place them next to them. It's not going to work. So the third option is adoption to the general public. But that's as bad as adopting a baby. It's not easy to do. And if they're beyond the point where they just can't be put out in the general population, they keep them right now in Texas. And they're trying to raise funds to build a full-time, we'll call it, for lack of a better term, not a kennel, but a farm, where they live out their lives the way they should. These dogs are heroes. Something I learned about these dogs is, for instance, there's corporals, sergeants, lieutenants, captains, colonels, generals. These dogs have saved an average of 200, okay, so there's approximately 400 to 500 dogs over there at any time working. They save an average of 200 lives per dog. That's a lot of lives to save. And they deserve to be treated with the same respect as their counterparts. And they're not always treated that way. So when I've worked with these dogs on several different occasions, and I see what they are, what they can do, and what they go through. So when I found out about this, with me, it was just a no-brainer. I contacted them, told them who I was, and what said I wanted to support the organization. I vetted them, they vetted me, and then we came to an agreement that I was going to support them. So I did, and last year I started. So whenever I go to an event now, and people buy my books, if they want to buy a book and they want me to sign it, I charge them $3. If they want me to personalize it, I charge $5. That money goes directly to the foundation. I also took it upon myself and said I was going to run a major fundraiser. So this November, November 14th, at the Four Point Sheridan in Wakefield, I'm running an event called Canine Gala. It's Mission Canine Rescue featuring thriller and mystery office. I'm bringing, so to this event, it's a black tie event, and it's a major event, and I'm bringing 27 authors from different parts of the country that are coming in to what I call their post office, and they'll sit, there's 27 tables. There's 27 authors. Each author sits at the table. He will be the host for that table, and whoever buys tickets to sit at that table will sit with that author. He'll give him a sign of one of his books, give him a sign book, and he'll spend the evening with him. Or any of the other authors who are going to be there. And a lot of the others, I have over, I think I'm up to, I have 27 total, 14 or 15, or somewhere there, New York Times best-selling authors. Not that the other authors are any the lesser, but these bigger names, some of the bigger names people recognize right away. So they volunteered to do this. They're not getting paid. I asked them to do it. I made friends with a lot of over the years. They didn't even hesitate. Yes. And they're going to come. And we're also going to have 4 to 6 of the rescued dogs there with their handlers, which is going to be pretty cool. We're also going to have an open bar cocktail hour, complete 5-course dinner. We're going to have Candy O'Terry from Magic 106 in Boston. She's going to be our MC and open up with the national anthem. We're going to have, we're working on something right now. A friend of mine, a retired Marine colonel, Andy North, who's an author with Kensington, and he's going to be coming to an event we're having in September. He is working on something for me because of his rank and his connections. We were going to try that night to do a Skype with an actual handler with his dog from Afghanistan. If we can pull that off, I'll have people, they'll be throwing money at us. It's going to be pretty good. We have some unbelievable auction items, live auction items. We're giving away a trip by Mercedes-Benz provider. It's called the Black Cross Package. We have a high bidder. We'll go into a Mercedes-Benz dealership in Thrillington. They'll sit down with you, custom build you a car. You fly to Germany. When you get there, Mercedes will pick you up, take you to the factory, give you a private tour, and give you that car to use for 2 weeks. All expenses paid for the car. You don't pay a dime. No insurance, nothing. They'll also put you up in a hotel, and you can go anywhere you want in Europe and drop that car off when you're ready to come back. We have a trip for four to Africa on a picture taking safari. We have another trip for the down in Germany, going down. Everybody see the Vikings commercial?
Yep.
That same type of cruise line. We've got stuff, signed stuff from Brady, Jersey signed and frame. We've got an exact, right down to the exact duplicate of the 2014 Patriot Super Bowl trophy. We've got a Steven Tyler signed guitar. Everything's documented, and plus a ton of other stuff. So it's going to be a pretty big event. So that's what I'm doing. Plus, Brittany and I, just about a month ago, had the opportunity to start our podcast. And we did, and we've done about 8 shows. Right around there?
Correct.
And it was going so well that I talked to the station, and we're going to actually, Monday after Labor Day, the plan is for us to start a live 3-hour call-in talk show every Monday from 3 to 6. And that's dual purpose. It's going to be called Street Talk with Maloney and Bang. Brittany has got her finger on the pulse of Boston. Everything that's going on in Boston, you know.
It's a lot of pressure, Leo.
Society, I mean.
Wow.
She's really it. My side of the show is going to be what's going on in the world of politics, with military, with Iraq, Afghanistan, all the crazy that goes on in the world. It'll be a live show, and I think it's going to be a lot of fun. Brittany's great to work with. She's just a natural at this stuff. And I just thought it was the next step. But my real main reason for doing it was kind of a selfish reason. Besides the point, I like to work with Brittany.
I don't know if I know this real reason, Leo.
Well,
why is the real reason?
Well, you know, one thing is, I'll be able to blab about my charity all the time.
Yeah.
And I'll be like Bill O'Reilly. I'll be talking about my books every single show, We'll be talking about my books and Brittany's, although she keeps saying, you know, what I do and her minds don't go together, but I think we can hook them up.
Oh, listen, Black Ops Mice? Who could resist?
Well, that's what I'm doing.
Well, in a nutshell, I was going to say, Kate, can you top that? I mean,
top that. But you know, one of the things I've discovered over the years sitting in the writer's chair, becoming less competitive than I was when I was a courtroom lawyer, they don't always have top. And that's part of the beauty of the mystery business generally, is that we really aren't competitive. We're really very supportive, which is why 27 authors will sign up in a minute and say, we want to come to the gala, and we're happy to host a table, and you know, we want to work together. And I organize mystery events, you know, the New England Crime Bay, which is our conference that takes place every November in Dedham. I've organized the Maine Crime Wave. Now we've got another one going on in Maine in the fall. But I think that, you know, in addition to the books, and I've got three next year, you know, the new Joe Burgess and the Warden's Memoir, which is fascinating because you think game wardens are just, you know, like, oh, guys who stop us from fishing and hunting deer. But basically, he, you know, was doing a huge amount of search and rescue, and then search and rescue with trained canines, and then search, and then cadaver dog searching and cadaver dog training. So, you know, I'm completely fascinated by the world of dogs, and you know, what I like to do is go out in the woods and get lost and get found by the canines as part of their training. So far, they haven't asked me to be.
We don't recommend you do that at home, folks.
you know, so I think that, you know, with teaching and helping other people write their books and these conferences, I'm just about as happy as a person can be, and I don't have to top anything.
Let me tell you something about Kate. I've been to numerous conferences with Kate. We've worked together before, but I've also sat and listened to her where I wasn't hogging the microphone. If you get the opportunity to go see her speak, do it. She's too modest. She's extremely good, very interesting. Sit there and you can just listen to her for hours because she's got a ton of stories to tell you. Get that opportunity. Don't pass it up. Get her books.
Isn't he a sweetheart?
Like, I feel like we are having that opportunity right now. So, I mean, I'd love to, does anyone have any questions for either Leo or Kate tonight?
I think a good story is, I know that when you went in the army, you just intended to serve out the time and go out. I think it would be a good story to tell of how what happened in the army led to where you are tonight, how that all started there.
So, for the tape, we should probably repeat that question if we can. Is it Frank?
I'm sorry?
Fred.
Fred's question is basically, you went into the army, he says, planning to just serve your term and get out. And things happened that changed the course of your life, and that's a good story to tell.
So, I was drafted, I went into the service, and while in the service, I was approached, and I was basically called up to my commanding officer's office one day, and there were these, this is a true story, there were these two guys, for those of you who see Men in Black, that's what they look like, exactly the same thing. And they asked me a bunch of questions, of which I answered, and then when I got through, I was told to go back to my barracks. About a week and a half later, so give or take, same thing happened. I called up, same two guys there, another bunch of questions. So this happened like three or four times, and I'm never being told why I'm being asked this, but I'm getting very nervous that the rest of my platoon think I'm some kind of rat, because you know, I could never, they would ask me and I'd say, I don't know, just because, but I was told not to tell them what I was being asked. So this went on about the fifth time I went up. They finally, they did some testing. They did some written tests, and then I did some psychological tests. And after they did the psychological test, I went back again. And then a short time later, maybe it was 3 weeks, I was called up again. And this time I went up and I was told who they actually worked for. And they said that I fit a particular profile. And when they said the profile, there were certain things they were looking for in somebody who worked for this organization. One of them was memory, the other part was leadership, athletic ability, fighting skills, marksman skills, a few other things. So they said to me, you fit our profile. And then they told me who they were, and they said, basically, they said to me, would you want to work for this organization? And I said, hell yeah. At the time, James Bond had just come up, this was in the mid-60s, and They said to me, you're going to be like James Bond, you're going to be the real thing. And I said, what do I have to do? They said, nothing, go back to the room, check him out, and we'll be told what to do. I went back, short time later, I was brought up, examined by a doctor, and told that I had a disability. And this disability got me out of the service. I was sent home, told I would be contacted in 30 days. I went home. I came home. My mother and father thought I went AWOL because I had no excuse of being home. I just showed up and I said, I got a disability. And they said, what's the disability? I said, I have a benign tumor in my right knee. And my father said, you had that before you went into service, which I did. But that's what they said my problem was. So about a little over 30 days, I got a phone call. And I was told to live off the town, take the train to Washington, D.C. I went, took the train, went to Washington, D.C., picked up by these two guys, put in a cab, was blindfolded, taken to where I was going to be training, went, trained for a year, and upon graduation, I finished in the top of my class, and then they offered me four different positions within the organization, and one of them was as a deep cover black operative. And I remember saying to them, I was at the time, so I was almost 21 by then, and I said to them, what does that mean? So they said, that means you come off the grid. Nobody will know what you do. You'll have many different IDs, many different discussions. You can't tell anybody what you do. Nobody can know what you do. And then we went on from there, and I said, where do I sign? And that was it. That's how it all started. I spent my next 30 years doing what I did.
This is for Michelle.
No, this is Kate.
It's all right. I'm Michelle tonight.
You can wait a minute.
Michelle's not here.
You can ask Michelle.
Michelle's not here.
Oh, you are in place of Kate.
I am. Yes. I'm a ringer.
You are a writer.
I'm the player to be named later. I'm the backup blonde.
Michelle got an assignment. Michelle works for ABC News, and she called me late this afternoon, and she got an assignment that she just couldn't say, no, I'm not going. So I panicked, pick up the phone, or actually I emailed Kate, and then when she called him, I asked her, please come and help me, and she did.
He needs a backup singer.
I kept hearing him call you Kate, and I wondered about that.
Yeah, it's because I'm in deep cover. I'm in shallow cover.
How does she, I don't know if you're going to answer for her, but how does she select the people that she's going to do true crime story? What criteria does she use?
That's a very good question. I do not know the answer to that. I would say that she probably goes for the high-profile Boston-related cases where she can get very good insider access.
Right.
And she's extremely good at that. You know, she really does have a talent for. She knows people. She can get the cops to show her stuff that she shouldn't be seeing. She can get the Hanleys to talk to her. She is very good, I think, if you read the books, at playing one person off against another so that she gets multiple points of view so that you see sort of the internal conflicts between agencies, between you know, people who want the story to come out and people who don't want the story to come out. And but that, you know, to some extent, that's the essence of true crime research.
How likely is she to do more?
She's writing right now.
True crime.
Yes.
She's got several things she's working on.
Most of them set in the Boston area.
I think so far she's done mostly Boston.
Yeah, she has, but she spent 10 years, which I just found this out yesterday during a conversation with her. She spent 10 years on the street report in New York, which she got a lot of respect for.
Oh, I mean, you have to be fearless and not back down and know how to get into people's faces and know how to work people and know if you can't get the answer here, where you go to do a roundabout to get the answer over there. Okay, so that's Michelle's answer.
Thank you. Do you write, did you say you write also?
True crime.
You do true crime as well. In this area or all around the country?
I did one in Maine and one in Canada. So far, I've only done, mine came to me through the Maine wardens. Or actually, the first one came because I was working with a cop as an expert for my books who would answer all my questions, and then he had this murder, and he said, I want to write about it, and he didn't know how. So I said, being his friend, well, I'll give you some advice, and the next thing I know, I was writing 90% of the book. You know, the 90-10 thing.
Yeah, I was saying, like, you were the ghostwriter.
That was the ghostwriter. But I wasn't a ghostwriter.
Right.
My name was on the cover. But it was really, really fascinating because what I got to do was write a book where I took an investigation from the first phone call to an off-duty cop, looking over the cop's shoulders as they worked their way through the whole story. And then, you know, and that was, I mean, that was really an amazing thing for them to be willing to talk to me. And then the Maine wardens came into that case and found the body. The book is called Finding Amy. And then when that book came out, the warden who organized the search came to me again and said, "So Kate, when you're ready, I've got another one for you." I keep waiting for him to call up, you know, because it's done now.
Yeah, it's fascinating.
It's, you know, it's, you know, he knows it, I have to learn it. But whichever way we act as the translators of this experience for you, it is a way of taking you into these worlds.
Thank you.
She can do it.
Hi, my name is Christina. I spent many years here as an English teacher, and I drove kids crazy all the time with writing and planning and pre-writing. And they really have to, you know, think about what you're going to write before you do it. So when you guys are writing either a book or you're going to do a whole series, how much of it do you try to plan in advance? Or do you like the experience of seeing where the writing sort of takes you?
You go first. Okay, for me, one of the reasons that when I started writing and stopped practicing law when my kids were little was that the mystery has a skeleton, so that it has a form, it has a format, so you know what the rules are, and that gives you something to hang your prose on if you don't actually know what you're doing. I do, you would call it pre-writing, I call it cooking, which is that sort of 2 or 3 month period when I'm found standing in the grocery store staring at the frozen peas while I'm thinking, no, if I put this in the crime scene, then I'll use that later too, and who's my other suspect, and no, and you know, and I actually feel as though I should wear the little tag like Paddington Bear has that says, if you find this writer, please return her too, because, you know, and so I know an awful lot of stuff before I write word one. It doesn't always turn out that way, you know. Characters misbehave, stories change, you meet the bad guy and you're wrong. There's lots of wonderful things that happen along the way that are different. And I very much enjoy that part of the process. But you know, the other thing you need to talk to your kids about
just came in.
Is rewrite. You know, we rewrite a lot. First draft is not what we turn in.
Okay, so your question was, do I plan? The only thing that I have planned is I know how the series is going to end. I know it's going to go down the board. Other than that, from book to book, I don't. It just what particularly hits. I just hear or see something that will set something off and I'll start writing. I don't have necessarily an ending in mind. It's hard to explain, especially probably because I know Keith does a little differently than I do, but I just have, I put myself in my own little world when I see something happen on TV or I hear something, and I'll create a story for it. And I just go through it. Because again, I know what's real and what can't happen, which makes it easier. So, like this, the book I'm gonna write right now, Morgan's Revenge, if that's what you call it, came almost off of something that happened towards the end of the book I just finished. Oh, it's gonna be standalone, but it gave me an idea. And I'm not sure where that's gonna take me by the time I'm done, but I don't wanna plan it because something could happen next week that's major that I could take off on. So other than the last one, which I know, unless my publisher and office and my editor say to me, no, you can't do that, I know it's going to happen.
Actually, I'm in a very funny place right now with respect to the Joe Burgess series, because I planned a quartet. It was going to be the 4 seasons. It was going to take Joe Burgess from a very sort of angry monk-like existence back into more of a normal world after all the homicides and all the awful stuff we'd seen over 30 years and on the job. And the titles had a certain rhythm. Playing God, The Angel of Milton Park, Redemption, and then the last book, the fourth book, was And Brand New Peace. And I felt like that was perfect. Only people said when they read the fourth book, we're not done with Joe Burgess, we want more Joe Burgess. And I said, but I've done the four seasons. I've accomplished my goal and think how beautifully, I ended the last book. And they said, this is May. We've got lots of seasons. We've got tourist season. We've got hunting season. We've got mud season. We've got black fly season. We've got plenty more seasons for you to use. And so I just turned in June the fifth of my four book series, as my husband calls it, and led them thus astray. One was about a doctor who thought he was God. One was a child murder, which was very hard to write. Redemption was a Vietnam vet. Burgess had been a vet, and his friend had even gone when they were just kids, 18-year-olds to Vietnam, is found dead, and he's never been right since he came back. And so the redemption is really, the last thing that Burgess can do for his friend. And then, And Brand New Peace is about the culture clash between traditional white Maine culture and Somali immigrants, and how you investigate a crime in a community where you don't speak the language and where they're essentially distrustful, hierarchical, patriarchal, and so forth. So it's been really such a journey.
Thank you. Are there any other questions tonight? Yes.
One of my favorite parts of the James Bond movies, which is why I don't think I like them as much anymore, is it was the gadgets. Seeing the car that can turn into a submarine. Now, technology has improved so much that it seems less fantastic to me. I was wondering if you could tell me about something cool that you've used, or I know there's a museum, I think in Washington, of cameras and pens and things like that.
Are you telling? That's in Langley.
Oh, okay. Can you tell us anything cool that you've seen?
Well, I was using the GPS before you people have known what GPS was. That's something that just came out in the last 10 years. What can I tell you? See, some things I just can't talk about. I really can't really talk about a lot. I'm still under, I have to be very careful. There's certain things I can say, and talk about certain things I can't. But there's some, I gotta tell you, I'm what you call a toys guy. I love toys, and I had some unbelievable toys. I mean, we had stuff. Now you gotta remember, I've been gone since 2001. We had stuff in the 80s and 90s that nobody even had an idea was out there. But it was that, it was that far in advance. That's all we're going to talk about.
Did you have a shoe phone?
Did I have a what?
A shoe phone.
Did I have a shoe phone? No, I personally did not have a shoe phone. I know they existed. There's a lot of stuff you see in a lot of the early movies, even now. I mean, they're showing more and more stuff. There's things, there were pens, there were poison pens. There were shoes that would come out and have a knife in it. A lot of that stuff wasn't far-fetched. Some of it was nuts. But one of the things with my termination of it was being made into a movie. And one of the things, when I signed my contract, before I signed my contract, it was agreed upon with the principals of Amber Entertainment, the movie studio in London. I said to them, I really want to do this, but if you are going to make Morgan, I'm trying to think of a lot of phrases. Okay, you can make Morgan like Bond, but not do the stupid things that Bond does. I don't want him to be an ass clown. I want him to do things. Morgan, anything in my books, anything, I've either done, I've seen done, or somebody could do. I don't want, and they agreed to that. They're not going to have to do crazy, ridiculous things. It was actually funny. The quick story. Ghostwriter was writing something for me in one of my scenes. Where it came from, I don't know. So he just decided he was going to write something, and he sent it to me. And I read it, and I'm going, what are you, sniffing glue? He wrote a scene where Morgan is chasing down a jet down the runway, running after a jet. It's just about to take off. He jumps up onto the wheel and lifts itself. And I'm saying, now, you can get on a jet and hide, but not that way. And I said to him, Kyle, where the hell did you get this from? He says, oh, I saw it on a movie. Yeah, exactly.
He saw Tom Cruise do that once.
That's not going to happen. So we took that out. I wouldn't let it in. They've been really good. They won't put that kind of thing. I mean, they're going to embellish a little bit. You have to keep the audience totally engaged. But they're not going to have them do all kinds of weird things. Because this, they're talking about a franchise for my film. They're talking about one, you know, at least one every book, which I hope that's going to happen. So you got to keep them relatively normal and not doing weird things. I mean, Morgan's a guy. You know, Morgan's me. I mean, I could be hurt. I was hurt many times. I could be killed. I mean, you know, they're not Superman. I mean, none of these in real life, your operatives, whether it's a deep cover operative or just a general operative in the field, they're human. They get hurt. They have feelings. They have, you know, they're human.
Well, do we have any more questions? Yeah.
Did your experience as a deep cover black operative help you in your job as a career police officer?
I'm not going to go there. No, I'm not going to touch that one. I'll answer this. Did it help me? In what way do you mean that? Did it help?
Well, maybe you learned something, you had some specialized training that you
Yes, I utilized things a couple of different times. And when I did it, they were looking at me like, what planet do you come from? But I had training. And there's one particular incident that I could tell you, which I'm not going to tell you. But are you a man? I thought so. But if you went back into the blog years ago, it had to do with a sniping going on down Shirley Avenue that happened. Now, my training, I did something with training I had, and everybody else was standing there with their thumb up their rear end and didn't know what to do. So, yes. But that's as much as I'm going to tell you.
Does anyone else have any other questions that either one of us, or maybe Leo can or can't answer tonight? Well, everyone, again, I thank you so much for joining us tonight. Kate, thank you so very much for coming tonight and being such a gracious pinch hitter. It was really such a pleasure to have you. And Leo, as always, it's such a pleasure working with you. And thank you so much for your service to our country. It really is. You really have some amazing people right in front of us. So thank you.
Our books, there's a bookstore out there that can sell our books. Kate has her books as well. If you're interested in books, we'll come out and sign them. If not, that's okay too. Thank you.
Everyone, thank you so much for joining us.